Welcome back to the PFC podcast. The views and opinions you are about to hear are the speakers and do not necessarily reflect those of anyone else. Now on to the podcast.
Welcome back to the PFC podcast. This is Dennis, and today I'm with Alex. How are you doing today?
Yeah, great, Dennis. Thanks. How are you?
I'm doing well. I'm doing well. And today I'd like to talk with you about your organization and the republishing of a very old book, Guerilla Surgeon, which is pretty famous with our community. So if you wouldn't mind just doing a real quick introduction of yourself.
Yeah, sure. Kia ora koutou. My name's Alex McDonald. I'm from New Zealand. My background is in the New Zealand Army. I also spent 12 years working in ambulance as a paramedic. And now my day job is as a medical student, but still involved in the Army Reserves. And about 4 years ago, a group of us started Kaitiaki Ora Tactical Medicine New Zealand, which is loosely our equivalent of SOMA. And today I'm here representing Tactical Medicine New Zealand to talk about the book, The Guerilla Surgeon.
Perfect, perfect. So if you wouldn't mind, I've read the book. It's been a hot minute. So if you wouldn't mind, just give me the cliff notes.
Yeah, for sure, Dennis. So the book, Guerilla Surgeon, which I've got a copy of here, is the third publication of the book. And it tells the story of Dr. Lindsay Rogers. Dr. Rogers was is a New Zealand-born and medically trained surgeon who served with the Special Operations Executive in Yugoslavia during the Second World War. And the book tells his story working with the partisans as they resist Nazi Germany in their fight for freedom, and moves through his experiences chronologically, integration, talking about some of the clinical challenges and some of the operational challenges, with some great stories of the interpersonal relationships and conflicts that happened throughout his time in Yugoslavia.
Perfect. So from what I remember of the book, it starts off, he's in Africa, and apparently Rommel wasn't enough. So he decided one day he goes into this tent full of these shadowy characters, and eventually they give him his wish, and he goes off to Yugoslavia. From what I remember, essentially by himself.
Yeah, that's not too far from the truth. He's there's a great story. He's talks his way into a day's leave in North Africa, where he's serving with the 8th Army in a casualty clearing station, and not engaged in active support at that time. Him and a friend, they hitchhike in a jeep and basically find themselves halfway between German and British lines, and they get spotted by Ford observers, and they think that actually what they're doing out there is a lot more interesting than sitting in the hospital. So inspired by that activity, they head back, and he basically talks himself into the commanding general's office of the Yugoslav campaign and says, "Hey, I'm a doctor, can I come help out?" And so he finds himself off to England to do training as a special operations executive operative, and then shortly after that, he's in Italy, and then on a boat into the island of Viz in the Yugoslav unoccupied territories.
Yeah.
And he heads out with two medical orderlies who are non-trained. He basically gets referred a couple of senior NCOs from the following forces, two Scotsmen, Bill and Ian, and they go with him, do the same training, and end up in Yugoslavia together.
Nice, nice. So, I mean, from what, again, I think it was about last year when I read this for the first time, you know, lots of surgeries, lots of moving, and lots of improvising, just because of lack of supplies. That always seemed to be the problem, was lack of supplies. You know, how do you see this, like, mirroring, you know, future conflicts?
Yeah, so, you know, this is a story that's about 80 years old, and we don't need to look too much into the future to see its relevancy. Some of the operations and conflicts around the world today have all the hallmarks that Rogers identifies in his story. Prolonged evacuation times, short supplies, difficulty getting resupply, and restricted freedom of maneuver, resulting in casualties having to be moved by night. You know, we just need to look at what's happening in Ukraine and Eastern Europe at the moment. And then layer into that the challenges of different political ideologies and different ideas about the post-conflict era around how much freedom Rogers and his team had to influence the medical outcomes of the casualties was often dictated by the political commissars. And if you sort of look at what's happening today, you know, as different countries vie for construction and rehabilitation, rebuilding post-conflict, I suspect a lot of those challenges still remain, particularly for a small group of, you know, uniformed military personnel operating in amongst a partner force in a foreign nation.
Yeah. You know, it's I think it's easy to influence when you outnumber everybody 100-1 and you're the only ones who have guns. So generally things go your way. However, when it's not that and you're three dudes, you know, amongst an entire army, you now have to say please, right?
So, yeah, that's right. And often some of the challenges Rogers and his team faced was that they were in a very small team of three. They had one or two contact points with the British mission. They're often alongside the Soviet mission, who was influencing the partisans heavily as well. And then they would find that they were part of a fighting force that was not necessarily welcomed in the area of operations because of the sympathies of the locals towards either the occupying force or another guerrilla force. So some of those challenges were faced on a daily or weekly basis by Rogers and his team as they go out on patrols and just not quite sure who they could interface and who they could trust.
Yeah. So, I mean, just kind of bringing in your experience as well, you know, when you're working with a local force, obviously they have different outlooks on medicine and what is realistic and what is the expectation of medicine. And us coming in, Westerners, you know, we have a different level that we consider acceptable and essentially mandatory for us. You know, how do you think, you know, in an environment like that, a lot is dictated, but a lot also can be influenced and moved in one direction or the other. You know, how best should a medical personnel, regardless military or not, how can they best influence the situation and advocate for their patients?
I think like most relationships, it all comes down to trust. And Rogers does a great job in his story about talking about the efforts and steps and hurdles that he had to go through to build the trust of the locals. My experience working with partner forces in the Pacific, it's about, you know, building the trust, being transparent, and just showing that you really care about their cause and their mission and that you're there to support them, and really just bringing them along on that journey or going along on the journey with them, that common mission in mind.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I've seen it too. And I think the locals are a bit easier because they're on the receiving end of generally your care. And it's really hard to be angry at somebody when you just save their child or husband or whatever it is. You know, generally they're more willing to do whatever it is that they can do. Politicians, on the other hand, are not so quick. You know, how can anybody really, you know, take that same kind of, you know, influence and apply it to, you know, the political side of things and try to mitigate the propaganda and BS to actually get the job done?
Yeah, look, I think if we all knew the answer to that, operations would be a lot simpler. But from what Rogers talks about is, you know, building the trust with the leadership first through the joint mission and getting to know the leadership. So he got to meet Marshal Tito, who was the head of the partisan force. He got to meet the first premier of the partisans as well. And it was really about just saying, hey, this is what we're here to do. We can get you medical supplies. We can provide that strategic effect through bringing in outside resources to support your forces. There were some challenges along the way, though, with that, which was that parachuting and medical supplies being received by the partisans, often they'd get a small percentage of what was airdropped as things were taxed along the way or redistributed. But really, I think in terms of influencing the political leadership, it's just about being genuine and showing that you're there and being part of the forces, and status of forces agreements aside, and sort of the overt and covert things that happen, it's all about building that trust. And then by showing through your actions what you're doing to the locals and supporting their population base and supporting the people that support them, that keeps you on side as well.
Yeah. A lot of times you talked about, you know, having to improvise for things that were single use, figuring out ways to get them clean so that they can use them again, because there's essentially no other options, right?
Yeah.
On the Western, world, that's essentially like unheard of. We would never use something that was single use only for more than one person. And it violates every principle that it's built, medicine is built upon. However, reality, we're going to have to.
Yep.
At what point do you essentially, would you start thinking about doing something like that, or starting to go, I guess the term, go ugly? You know, it's easy when you're forced to, and I have one now, but that's generally probably not the smartest idea.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think it comes down to your prior preparation and your planning. As we know, medical planning is a foundational aspect of providing medical support, and knowing where you're going to get your next provisions from, understanding the tactical situation and the time you have to move, whether you look to establish caches, whether you hold things in reserve, is all dependent, obviously, on the time and tactics of the situation. But really, if you are in a pure guerrilla warfare setting, or in a resource austere setting, then you really want to start looking at other ways that you can achieve the same effect with other resources without using your high-end or your single-use items if you can. So in my personal opinion, I think using some of those extra resources early, as long as they provide the same clinical outcome and clinical effects, you'll probably want to start using them early so that you can keep some of those items for the higher-end casualties. Otherwise, you're just going to burn through everything pretty quickly, and it's going to do no good for everyone, right? Yeah. So Rogers tells some pretty interesting stories about arriving at a partisan hospital and seeing a roller bandage or piece of Kulak sort of used so many times that it's just fraying on the patient and not actually doing anything. They were washing roller bandages 10, 12, 15 times, and not necessarily in ideal sort of aseptic conditions, just in a pot over some boiling water. They were reusing splints, they were reusing all sorts of things. But looking widely, there are other things that you can do as well. So using the local expertise and the partisan force, it's almost like a reserve force from a military sense, where all these people come with a range of skills and civilian trades that they can use for that medical effect. So using builders and craftsmen to build splints, to use build traction devices for fractured legs, etc. Using people who are cooks or people who work in the cleaning industry to help with the sterilization or building those aseptic techniques. So it really becomes a whole force scenario. So you as the clinician don't need to necessarily solve that all yourself. Use your force, use your partner force, use their expertise, use their ability to resource things through their local networks to help you build your capability.
Yeah, I absolutely. You need to, just look at the talents of the people around you and use them to your best advantage, right?
For sure.
Everybody comes with something. You're just going to have to figure out what it is. Likewise, there's some things that they're not going to come with, like a certain amount of education in whatever techniques you're going to do, or maybe it's a new job, essentially. How do you go about taking somebody from zero, let's say medically? Like, I need a surgical assistant. Nobody, I'm the only surgeon around, or the closest one that pretends to be one. How do you even begin?
Yeah, so that's quite well explained during Roger's biography. He talks about taking his two non-medical assistants and then training them up to be his medical assistants. And by the end of the war, they were basically running as anaesthetists and putting patients under, doing a lot of IVs, doing a lot of simple medication admissions, as well as partnering with the locals who were medical students, nurses, caregivers in their pre-war life, So finding those people with a foundation, whether it be first aid, basic first aid, or something more advanced, and then putting them in the right spot and using an apprenticeship model. The challenge with that is it's going to take a lot longer to get through procedures. So you've got to balance the, can I do this alone quickly, or can I build the capacity of those that we're working with over time to provide a greater effect to the force? By the end of the conflict, Rogers is sort of the superintendent, if you will, of a number of partisan and guerrilla hospitals where he would travel around on an almost weekly basis. And he might get to some of these hospitals once every 7 to 10 days, perform the surgeries that needed to occur, and then hand over care to the locals. And with that long-term view in mind, which, you know, is it potentially a challenge for us as we talk about deployments of 6 to 12 months from our militaries. But if you've with that force for 1, 2, 3 years, you've got time to build that network and basically run someone through a nursing degree or a medical residency if you've got the time and the willingness of the local population. One of the other things to consider there is language and cultural proficiency. Mm-hmm. When Rogers and Bill and Ian, his two orderlies, were preparing for the mission, they learnt one language, and when they arrived in the occupation zone, they were faced with partisans that spoke a different dialect or a different language. And so it took them a long time to get that cultural proficiency, cultural competency to, one, maintain the trust, but also then enable them to act as a mentor, a tutor in those medical skills. So not only do you have to be a good teacher as a clinician, you need to have that cultural competency to bring the people that you're training along with you and have that long-term view.
Yeah. And I mean, it's nothing that's like spycraft. It's just being a like good human, right? Learn how to communicate with people, treat people decently, you know, show them that you're there to help them. And like, I need your help to do these other things. So let me at least slowly start teaching you. Luckily, you know, World War II, Yugoslavia, LISCO in the future, there'll be plenty of opportunities to practice. So the speed of education is probably going to go a lot faster.
Absolutely. And so 2 points that I think come out from what you just said. One is, as a clinician, as a medic involved in the medical field, it's on us now to prepare for those future conflicts by learning those instructional techniques, becoming a good tutor, becoming a good mentor to your subordinates, your peers, so that you have those skills prior to deploying. And the second thing is, when you're with a partner force, because you're treating the partner force, the willingness of those people that you're training is probably a lot higher because they are treating their friends and their family in a lot of cases. So the motivation to quickly master those skills is there. So use that motivation, take their existing knowledge and really enhance it through that apprenticeship model.
Yep, perfect, perfect. So, you know, you mentioned your organization, TechMed New Zealand.
Yep.
You know, can you tell me a little bit about it?
Yeah, sure. So Kaitiaki Ora Tactical Medicine New Zealand is New Zealand's first and only tactical medicine association. It was started in 2020, about 3 weeks before the first COVID lockdowns hit New Zealand. So we had a bit of a false start, but we've really grown from strength to strength since then. A big part of my focus as the president has been building the international network and contributing to a lot of international things. So we've partnered with the Thor Network. We've been represented at SOMA last year, and some work's being done to formalize a relationship there. And our big relationship is with the Australian Tactical Medicine Association, who also run a fantastic conference every September in Brisbane, Australia. Our mission, like most of those other organizations, is really to promote and advance tactical medicine in New Zealand. So what we're about is taking the lessons learnt internationally and nationally and making sure that we've got a conduit for that information to be passed on to the current and future generations of tactical medicine professionals. The way we do that is through our conference, CRIC, Critical Resuscitation and Chaos, which this year will be our third offering of the conference, and it's focused towards those first responders and military medics, as well as their leadership and industry, to come along and look at vignettes, look at case studies, look at developing sciences around the delivery of tactical medicine. We're excited this year with the Guerilla Surgeon to formally relaunch the third publication of the book at our conference. And we've got Chris Pugsley, who's a retired New Zealand Army Lieutenant Colonel, and he's New Zealand's leading military historian, coming along to do that relaunch as well as looking particularly this year at 5 years since the March 15th terrorist attack, where a lone gunman massacred 54 New Zealanders and wounded about 50 others who were at Friday prayers in two local mosques. So we're going to look back at that and understand the lessons that we can learn from that tragedy and how we can apply them moving forward.
Perfect, perfect. And so you mentioned you partnered with SOMA. Tell me a bit about that.
Yeah, so I was fortunate enough to get across last year, talk to John, the current president, and Sean, the president-elect, talking about how we could partner. And one of the most tangible things that we could do is look at getting this book republished. So a big debt of thanks to SOMA and its membership for funding the book being republished. The proceeds of the book will go to SOMA and to Tactical Medicine New Zealand. So there's no personal gain from any of this. It's to the two charities. And there are going to be copies of the book available for sale at SOMSA this year. They're currently on their way to Raleigh. So they'll be there in time for you to head along and pick up a copy of the book. That's going to be marketed through SOMA. And for those who are in New Zealand and Australia, you can reach out to us at info@tacticalmedicinenz.com or come along to our conference where copies will be available for sale as well. And I think that's the strength of the relationships of the international tactical medicine community, is we can surge effort and expertise and resources, pull them together to do things like rekindle this great piece of history.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Is there anything else that we need to put out?
The key things I guess I want to take away is that, Guerilla Surgeon is a story of one man from a country in the bottom end of the world that a lot of people in Europe had never heard about. He went over, he sought out the adventure and sought to find the place where he could best use his talents and skills as a surgeon to achieve a greater effect in the battle space and the operational environment. So this is really comes back to what we try to do in special operations, which is go out and have a disproportionate effect for the size of our force. He is a true testament to the work and that ethos. He's taken a couple of young men with him, and he's built a real network of hospitals where he was able to treat a large number of wounded, both civilian and combatant, over the 3 or 4 years that he was involved in that operation. When he came back, Lindsay Rogers settled in the North Island and continued his practice and ended up donating all his farming land that he built over his post-military career to the local school, which again just gives testament to the fact that he was a giving man who was able to do a lot with what he had and pass it on for the greater benefit. And I think if that's a guiding principle in our lives, then we'll go on to do great things as individuals. I'd also like to acknowledge the fact that Rogers was not alone in this effort. This was a huge team effort. And other surgeons, most notably William Defoe of Canada, who produced the parachute ward, and they actually met during their time in Yugoslavia, shares similar stories, except he did a lot of his operations under parachute canopies in the forest and moving. So by reading those two vignettes, those two case studies, we as modern military medical practitioners can learn a whole lot about how we can support a partner force and deliver disproportionate effects with our capabilities and our skills in the current or the next conflict.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a great book. I wouldn't say it's something that you're going to learn a lot of medicine out of, but as far as learning how to make do, how to overcome challenges, how to fight and win essentially in your mission against incredible odds. Like, this is definitely a great book.
Yeah, I think the key takeaway is you're not going to learn medicine, you're not going to learn tactics, but you're going to learn how to think about approaching the problem that you faced. I think it's a timeless tale. The clinical vignettes are interesting, but more so about the challenges about how you deliver the effect and understanding that our role as medical providers may actually involve us to carry a weapon and provide lethal force at times as well, and understand the political structure. So it's a great story. I've really enjoyed reading it. It's been a real pleasure to get it republished. And I think everyone will take something away, whether you are a clinician or a non-clinician, working in a guerrilla warfare space.
Perfect. Perfect. Well, thank you, Alex. I really appreciate it.
Thanks, Dennis. It's been a great pleasure. Love the podcast. Love what you're doing. And just real humbled to be just a small part of it. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. For today's podcast, be sure to go to our website, www.prolongfieldcare.org. Find us on Facebook, YouTube, Instagram. Subscribe and stay on the bleeding edge of combat medicine. This is Dennis for the PFC Podcast. Our boy is waiting there for you.